What would you say if I told you that Mrs. Lucas was going to have a baby?
I'd say she had a younger man in her life.
Okay. Would you believe it if I told you that Mrs. Lucas is pregnant?
Huh? Pregnant. Come on. Yeah. That's impossible. Man.
Yeah.
Pregnant.
Yeah, I know. I know what you mean. A woman her age.
No, I'm not surprised about Miss Lucas. I'm talking about you. I just didn't realize that at your age that you know, your boys could still swim.
My boys could still swim? Much baggage in 30 years at the airline.
Hello, everyone. Don't adjust your seats. Well, whatever. Screens. This is not Charlie Rose. This is Dougie Doug, actor, producer, director, entrepreneur, world-class figure skater, and gynecologist. And we're here at the show, and we're looking. We're here to interview people who are interesting and who don't cost much. At any rate, we have the author here by the name of Art Garfield. And he's our first guest, and he's a fantastic gentleman. He wrote this book, Power Was My Mentor, How America's Favorite TV Dad Helped Me to See the Big Picture. First, hey, hello, Arthur. I'm Art, sorry. Mama calls him Art, Arthur.
Hey, Doug.
Hey,
Doug.
My first question, thank you. My first question is, who is this America's TV Dad? Is it, you referring to Caitlyn Jenner?
No!
That's America's favorite TV dad now. You know, television has changed a tad.
He's probably America's favorite TV mom now.
Oh, I'm sorry. That's right. I forgot. That was incorrect.
Yeah.
That was incorrect. I apologize. So who are you talking about when you talk about
America's favorite TV dad,
I know,
man.
Who you're talking about.
Yeah. Bill Cosby.
Right. Yes. And so having said—
Not Bill Controversy.
Right. Well, thanks for saying that.
Sorry.
Because— to piggyback off of that, given the nature of his controversy, it's very interesting, having read this book, that it focuses on a lighter side of his legacy and sheds light on maybe some things that he did that didn't have anything to do with pinching inappropriately.
Oh, man.
The first question is, did he pinch you inappropriately?
He never pinched me, and I don't know how to feel about that. You know,
you don't know how to feel about him not pinching you? Given
the exposure that all the other people have, you know, have gotten from that, you know.
Well, this is true.
All I did was write a book, you know, a positive book.
Well, I'm glad that you wrote it because, and I'm glad that it's in proper English. Power was my mentor. Because you could have wrote it in, you know, black vernacular. You could have wrote, Power be my mentor. And then it would have, you know. But how do you feel about that, being a writer that writes in, doesn't write in black vernacular? Are you a black writer? You know, it's a pretty controversy. You're a black writer, you're a writer, you know, discourse.
I'm a black man who's a writer, which makes me a black writer.
Right, so I'm glad we got that settled. Your book has a very interesting cover. It has an image of a microphone and a pen underneath it. So what is the meaning of that particular symbol?
Well, the symbolism is, I'm a stand-up comedian as you are yourself.
Yes.
And I transition to writing. So the symbolism means from the stage to the page.
I see. That's very clever, by the way. From the stage to the page.
Yes, well, thank you.
That's what you should have named this book. From the stage to the page.
And that power was my mentor.
Because then it would have been able to translate beyond, you know, the thing with the pinching and the drugging. Well, and the drugging and the pinching. I'm just kidding. No, it's a great book. Wait. It's a great book, and when people read the book, they'll see what you mean by power.
And not only that, but you know, I wrote this book and created that cover prior to the controversy.
Right, that's important to know. Yeah.
You know, I mean, because if I would have known that this other stuff would have been coming up, it might have been a baseball bat with a pen at the bottom of it or something like that, I don't know.
Or a woman's behind.
Or a woman's behind.
Perhaps.
That's, you know, is a big fat ass on where the microphone is.
That's right. And it could be, power was my incentive.
You know, penetration was my mentor. No, I don't know how to. This interview. Penetration was my mentor.
It's sliding off the rails.
Yes,
very quickly.
We are way, way off.
But speaking of being a stand-up comedian, which we didn't speak of it. I just needed to get away from the butt thing.
Yes.
But As a stand-up comedian, how did you transition from being that to writing for Bill Cosby, which is obviously a very impressive credential?
Yeah, I mean, I started off as the warm-up comedian for the show, and the warm-up comedian is the guy who's up in the stands with the audience during the taping of the show to keep the, you know, the audience intrigued and excited and awake mm-hmm. and involved with the show and the storyline, and to keep them laughing in between all the, you know, the long delays sometimes that happen in between takes.
Well, as far as the timeline is concerned, how, like, take me through the steps of how that happened. So, and or take the audience through the steps of how that happened.
Okay, well, I was, listen, I was watching TV one night, Cosby was on Letterman, and this discussion was about him coming back to TV, and Cosby said, well, you know, coincidentally, I am coming back to TV, got a brand new series, and it's coming on this network, which is CBS, which is Letterman's network. And I'm going, whoa, if Cosby's coming back to TV, then more than likely he's going to be shooting at the same studio that he shot his original series, The Cosby Show, in Queens, New York. And of course, you know, we're all from New York. You know, you're mm-hmm. from New York, you're from Brooklyn. Mm-hmm. And I live in Harlem, but I'm from Queens. But anyway, mm-hmm. I've been to that studio before, and I knew exactly where it was. So I went down there and to inquire about the warm-up job. Mm-hmm. And he had one of his old buddies from Philly, some comedian, who nobody knows who the hell he is, right. doing the warm-ups. I guess he begged Cosby to do the warm-ups, give me a break, and Cosby has a way of allowing people to hang themselves.
Yes.
And so he let the guy, you know, do the warm-ups. The guy was terrible. So it was just ironic that I showed up looking for the warm-up job when the supervising producer asked me if I was available. I told her that I did warm-ups for Malcolm Jamal Warner's spinoff series.
Here and Now.
Here and Now.
Yeah.
She was like, wow, okay, you've already worked for Carson Warner Productions on one of their shows. That sounds good. When are you available? And I was like, I'm available now. Mm-hmm. And she's like, oh, my God, thank God, because we need to get rid of this guy because he's terrible. And I literally came in and got the job that same day.
Wow.
And so next thing I'm on the set. I'm doing the warm-ups and having a great time with the audience and doing my job. After the second taping, Cosby saw me heating up the audience and having a good time. And as you know, there's not a comedian that can walk into a club or walk into a space where a comedian's on stage and he's getting huge laughs and they don't want to get a piece of that action.
That's true.
And so he wanted to get a piece of the action. He saw me getting laughs and said, Garfield! Mm-hmm. And I couldn't believe that he said my name because I have not met him up to this point.
Right.
And I was in the with the microphone. I said, did he just say my name? And the audience said, yeah. He says, of course I said your name. And he threw me the microphone and I threw him the microphone. And he went on to do 10 minutes of improv of hilarity, mm-hmm. and then threw the mic back, gave me a nice blessing, give Garfield a round of applause. He's doing a great job up there, isn't he? Everybody applauded, and then the next thing you know, I'm being called into his dressing room for a conversation. But I know what the conversation was about was there was a joke I did about what I did was I incorporated the whole set. And mm-hmm. the workers and everybody into my warm-up, you know, funniness. And on the set was a street scene, and on the street scene there was a newspaper stand next to the subway, and there was a black guy in front of the newspaper stand. That's mm-hmm. who, you know, he working it. So I asked the audience, what is wrong with this street scene that's just not New York? And nobody could figure it out. I said, there's a black guy in front of the newsstand. There's not a black guy in New York City working a newsstand. It's always some guy that talk like this. Put that newspaper down. Don't you touch the chiclets. Walk away. Proper change. Blah, blah, blah. And I would get a
laugh.
That's
offensive.
It's very.
Now I know why he dragged your ass in the room.
and it was pretty much that. He, right. You know, he wanted to talk about that particular joke. And, you know, his point of view was.
Now, if you had had the Indian guy saying, you know, you have wonderful breasts. I want to touch them. You'd have been like, well, you know, we'll leave it at that.
Like, yeah, what is, look at the black
oh
women.
Oh my God, I want to give you a pill.
You know we got coffee, oh.
So badly.
Oh, man. We don't only sell now, papers, we got cappuccino, all kinds of things.
Now, after reading this book, speaking of that encounter that you had in his office,
right.
Which I know is code for a slashing.
Well, here's what it's like. The slashing was also educational, though.
Of always.
I mean, because he said, listen, if you're going to talk about any particular people or culture or whatever, tell the truth about them first. Right. Don't just go out there and do a joke. He goes, because he said, listen, why do you think the people were laughing? And I didn't. He said, why do you think the black people? He started breaking it down. Well, why do you think the black people were laughing? Mm-hmm. I said, well, the black people might be laughing because, you know, the funny voice. He goes, yeah, that's probably it. He goes, why do you think the white people were laughing? I said, and after about three I knew if you don't know the answer and you're talking to Bill Cosby, just say you don't know the answer. Right. Don't try to make one up. So I said, I don't know. And he said, they're laughing because you're making fun of them, those people, for them, because they can't fuck with those people.
Right.
You know, this is the language he used. They can't fuck with those people because those people are coming from a third
world. They think the voice is funny, but they can't say that the voice is funny.
Yes, right. Because these same people are coming from a third world country and taking their jobs.
Right.
They're becoming doctors, they're becoming lawyers, homeowners, business owners, dry cleaners, 7-Elevens, etc. He goes, meanwhile, the black people who have been indigenous, basically, to this country, you know, who the ones who are here, aren't doing these jobs. You know, he goes, so, and they don't know who to be, and black people don't know who to be mad at, because these people coming in with higher educations and what have you. And he goes, so I say that to say, if you're gonna make fun of anyone, or anything, just tell the truth about it. Then you can goof about it all you want.
Right.
And I was like, that's a pretty good approach. I'd never, you know, look at it like that. Mm-hmm. But then when I look at other comedians like Chris Rock, that's basically what he does. He'll set it up with the truth and then just go off, you know, on a tangent about
it. And then people will accept, oh, this is just a joke.
Right.
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 It's interesting that you mentioned some of these intimate conversations that you had with him, and you exposed some of his philosophy and points of view. And you do it quite a bit in the book. And
in Power Was My Mentor?
And the book, Power Be My Mentor. Kill My Landlord. Kill My Landlord. C-I-L-L, My Landlord. sorry. Anyway. Yeah, I mean, you have intimate conversations where you expose essentially not only his methodology, but his approach to politics and so forth, and some of his insights about human nature.
Yes.
Do you have any reservations about sort of airing this about him in particular, or just in terms of writing about a public figure?
Well, you know, this book is, you know, it's an intimate story, true, about how he, you know, kind of came to my rescue.
Right.
And so, I mean, there's nothing tawdry in there. My experience wasn't tawdry, so there's nothing bad. It was a fantastic experience.
Right.
You know, I went from being the warm-up comedian to being invited to watch the process of the show.
Yes.
You know, by him. And he said,
but there were bumps in that process. I mean, some really serious bumps you mentioned in the book. And you did get into a political web and tangle. And you were also fired as well.
Yes.
Not from the writing staff, but as the warm-up comedian.
Yes.
Which is very interesting. Like, the book is not only about him, but it's also about the industry.
Yes.
And so what were the things that you found that were shocking or interesting about the television industry? Because it's a great book for people who want to be television writers, irrespective of their race or what have you.
No, what I've learned is they don't like our black asses. That's what I learned. They ain't like him. And they don't. Right. They don't. You know, there's something about the TV. From my observation, mm-hmm. that it's a very coveted world.
Right.
And
a lot of checks.
A lot of checks.
A lot of people that want them.
Yes, big checks.
And would prefer you not have.
And they like to circulate it within themselves.
Indeed. Yeah.
And
indeed.
So that's one of the things I've learned because. Just the idea of me having the audacity and notion of wanting to be a writer on that show,
you know,
made them, to their chagrin. It was like, how dare you? How dare you want to aspire to be a part of what we do?
Yeah, I mean, and you were audacious. I mean, you essentially inserted yourself. I mean, you didn't really insert. I mean, you were invited by Mr. Cosby after you were fired to participate in the and to observe the production and be in the writer's room, which is really, in retrospect, a very coveted opportunity.
Very.
I mean, for people who are professional writers, they would like to be there for free.
Yes.
So were you naive and didn't realize, like, really where you were and what you were confronting?
I did not know the full gravity of what I was throwing myself into. Mm-hmm. But what I did know that was I had to be very careful.
Yes.
And walk on eggshells, so to speak.
But you weren't. You were not careful sometimes.
Oh, because I was new. So right. there was a lot of greenhorn things going on. Yeah. That was easily being checked, you know, as I went along. But I learned
and taken advantage of.
Yeah.
I mean, the relationships in this book are very, very complicated relationships.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, could you elaborate on some specific, people or things that?
Well, besides Cosby,
right?
Besides Cosby welcoming me into this process in front of everyone, mm-hmm. because when they did fire me, they fired me because they saw him getting close, me getting close to him.
Yes.
And and once that kind of thing happens, they feel it's out of their control.
Yes.
And so they tried to, check me, but they checked me hard. They checked me by firing me, saying that I said something anti-Semitic to someone. And, as much as I want to tell them I have Jewish friends, it was no space for me.
I have a black friend.
there was no. I could look at these.
I love the blacks.
Yes, let me call my friend Ira. Let me put Ira on the fucking Ira show and vouch for me. Anyway.
I mean, I know what you're referring to, and if anybody ever really examined that part of the book, they would see that it was some chicanery,
big time
going on.
Big
there.
Time. And so, essentially, what happened was, Cosby recognized me. I showed up. I took advantage of him allowing me to watch the process of his show. And I showed up at a writer's meeting with everybody else, with the whole cast and everything, which was odd. The person who fired me saw me sitting in the room and was like, what the fuck is he doing here?
Right.
And Cosby came into the writer's, the read-through with the whole cast, you and everybody, Felicia Rashad, Madeline Kahn, mm-hmm. Takiya, Christophe Kema. And I was sitting in the back trying to be inconspicuous because I knew I was fired. But
it's the right move for a fired person.
but showing up.
How y'all doing? Power be my mentor. Which actually would have been an appropriate thing. That's kind of like, back, bitches. Imagine you're fired.
Right.
Power be my mentor. That's why I'm here. That would have been very cool.
Yeah, well, my mentor walked into the meeting, and he did his joke. Remember how he used to do a joke and crack the whole room apart? But the very next words out of his mouth was, has anybody seen Garfield?
Right.
And one of the other producers who did not know I was fired said, he's right there.
You're
and I was
pretty
like,
bright guy.
Yeah. And then that was it. That solidified my presence, on the set, to the dismay of those who fired me. He's no longer under your jurisdiction. He's under mine.
That's the old pissing on the fire hydrant routine.
Okay.
It's like, this is my fire hydrant.
Right. Okay. I never heard of that before.
You know how you piss on, you don't know about dogs?
I know dogs.
Dogs piss on fire hydrants to mark their territory.
Yes. Oh,
so what he was doing,
he was pissing
on you.
On me?
Well, not on you. This thing has slid way far away from where power was my mentor.
Yeah, because
he wasn't pissing, what I'm saying? He was marking
me with
as
P.
Maybe I shouldn't use the P thing.
Yeah.
Was there anything in this book?
Especially in light of everything that's going on around him. I'm the one who got peed on. Maybe I can go and tell people why I think I got peed on.
But you could do that. But you can do it like I was peed on. Metaphorically.
Metaphorically.
You know what I mean?
I was peed on.
And maybe you could get some money for that.
Yeah.
There's certain details in this book that you agonized over including?
Besides being peed on?
Like, you wrote about me, which was very strange.
Well, you were
very strange.
You were an integral part of my existence on that set because you and I were friends prior to, the show.
That's
true. We were very familiar with each other. We were friends.
Yes.
And so I really did not know that you were on the show.
Oh, that's interesting. That's deep.
Yeah, until I was in the audience with the microphone and about to do warm-ups, and you popped, you came onto the set when they introduced everybody, and I'm like,
that's sad. That they did no marketing whatsoever of my participation.
Well, no, they didn't.
That's happened to me before countless times in films and television products. And I feel really depressed about that. But enough about me.
No, but the bigger picture is the show wasn't about you. So
what do you mean?
It was Cosby.
Peripherally cool. About me.
Right.
But not directly.
Yes. But it was a blessing to me that you were there.
Thank you.
Because what wound up happening was I was able to go backstage in the dressing room area and hang out on that level.
You had like a sanctuary of sorts. Yeah,
big time sanctuary.
And I didn't deliberately provide that for you. I just wanted to hang.
I didn't know that's where you.
I had no idea because reading the book, I realized you were under enormous distress.
Yes.
I mean, having had been worked in television, film, whatever, for so long at such a tender age.
Yes.
I wasn't really conscious of people under that kind of anxiety and stress because to me. Being on a set was just second nature. As a matter of fact, I was much more comfortable on a set than I was maybe in real life.
Right, right.
So I was like, so I didn't really notice, and I didn't assume that you were as anxious as you were from reading this book.
Well, because I didn't want to. It wasn't my place to put that on you. You were my friend.
Right.
This was in a professional capacity.
Right.
And I'm a grown ass man.
Right.
So I wasn't going to come to you or anyone, with whatever anxieties that I was experiencing while I was there. My whole purpose was to get along and try to absorb whatever is going on this show and see how I can fit in. You know, so but your facilitation as my friend and professionally recognizing why I was there, and that the opportunity, was something, a lot bigger than our friendship. You created that haven. You created that comfort zone, for me to be able to navigate and stroll around there. But let's
get real, because people talk about.
I wasn't just kissing your ass just now, was I?
No.
Okay.
But you were peeing on me though.
Sorry, man. Sorry.
Well, let's get real about the industry. I mean, you talk about sort of the subtle racial hostility, but there was also overt expressions of race hate. I would say. I think it qualifies as race hate. There were people on the show who basically directly. I guess we shouldn't talk about what role this person played, but that said directly, look, black people are not qualified to write straight up.
Well, further on during my tenure there, during that season, I had, because I'm watching the show and observing the show, I have access to the scripts and I know the characters because I'm watching every day. I also am communicating with some of the writers who were friendly to me. Excuse me. I went and took a writing course at the New School downtown Manhattan, for script writing, sitcom writing, and didn't tell anyone on the set. It is something I did very independently. And for my script, I picked the Cosby series that you're on because I was familiar with the characters. So I wrote this script, and I eventually pitched it to Cosby. By this time, we were, we had a rapport going on, and I would, practically hang on him every day, and you yourself. And I pitched the story to him, and he loved the story. Mm-hmm. He loved the story. He told me to, ask me if it was finished. It wasn't finished. And he goes, come in tomorrow and tell the showrunner about this idea, and tell him that I sent you. And I'm like, no, he hates me. I'm not going to. He's wondering why I'm still here, because he was there when I got fired. He was part of that crew of firing. So I don't want to pitch this to him. He's not going to be open. Tell him, Cosby said, tell him I told you to come and talk to him. So between that and me going home and finishing the script, because it was not done, by the time I got in the next day, I would usually arrive typically every day with the whole crew, staff and crew, at 9 o'clock in the morning. This particular day, I came in at 12 because I was up all night long finishing this script.
I see.
And so when I came in, the stage manager came looking for me. Garfield, where are you? Ms. Cosby looking for you? I'm like, looking for me for what? He goes, something about some script you wrote. I'm like, what? When I finally caught up with Cosby, he's like, yo, come here. I'm like a little boy yelling, whispering to me, come here. And he goes, did you bring the script? And I was like, no, it's at home. But he goes, bring it in and get your money. I'm like, what are you talking about? He goes, I pitched it. They love it. Come and get your money. I'm like, blew my mind. I pitched it to him one day. He pitched it the next day. It was sold. sold. So what was your original question?
Well, I mean, I talked about the overtness.
Yes.
And because I think you went on a stream of consciousness because we
and you were
leading
about,
to
you were
the showrunner who
about,
disliked you
yes.
and his particular commentary
yes,
to
because,
you, which was to me qualifies as race hate.
Yes, because
I had to say that twice.
Now that I had a script that was in the pipeline,
uh-huh.
his thing was, how come you didn't come to me, the showrunner?
Right.
How come you didn't come to me with
directly.
This?
So yes. now he has an additional grudge against you.
Yes. Not only did I write a script, but I didn't bring it to him.
Yeah, but he's saying that while he's been looking at you like he wants to stab you.
Exactly. Now,
just a little show business inside.
Yes.
Why didn't you come to me, the person who wants to stab you?
Exactly. Exactly. And in my mind, I'm saying, because if I would have brought it to you, it would have
right.
been done.
Of course.
I took it to the person who I know would at least
right.
consider it.
Yeah. You did what a person who is trying to enter into the business and to get a shot needs to do, which is to be ingenious
yes.
about the way you approach things and
yes.
to not be straightforward, because you'll end up on the boulevard of broken dreams. Continue.
And within this conversation with the showrunner about my script,
yes.
he went on to, and it's detailed in the book more so than what I'm going to bullet point right now.
Mm-hmm.
He said, I know why you didn't come to me, because if you came to me, just, it would have never gotten
right.
done.
He finally let it out.
He was like a Republican, you know, trying to, you know, cover up, you know, their
right.
dishate for black people.
Right. And
you know?
and little girls.
And little girls.
Their love for little girls. They hate for black people, their love for little girls.
right. Right. Their sacrifices.
Right.
Yes. And so, you know, he said things like, you know, listen, I got a stack of scripts behind me from black
right.
writers. You know, none of them are any good.
Right.
Why don't you go write for the Wayans
Brothers? Trying to get in your head, yeah.
You know, all that kind of stuff. And essentially trying to get in my head. But
yeah.
I'm, you know, being a grown-ass man, I was a couple of steps ahead of
right.
all that.
You,
and I knew that he was trying to get me to go there.
Yeah,
he was trying to
belittle
me to
you and make you angry.
Trying to make me go black.